could go on all day, so I'm gonna go through it in 45 minutes and try to hit the highlights for you. But before we get started, I don't really feel like I know who's here in the room. So maybe we could introduce ourselves. Now we'll start over here.
Okay. I'm Nancy Markred. I'm treasurer for the Penthouse Conference.
Yay.
So I'm looking at this from multiple views.
Okay.
But I'm from Bedford, small rural church, Trinity, and I'm excited about what I've heard and excited to hear what more did.
I'm Gerald Lane. I'm the treasurer for Grace and Ed Church here in Kane, and I'm really interested in what I've heard so far and hope to be able to put it forth to the congregation.
What's your first name?
Susan.
Susan.
And Sister Trish, my church. And I'm Lisa Ford. I'm also from Trinity United Church up the street here, and I am the treasurer.
I'm Donald Murray, and I'm on the financial committee of the First United Church of Christ in Evansburg. I'm with Alan, and I'm the treasurer.
All right.
I made the spec. I'm the pastor right now at First Trinity in Youngwood, and our treasurer having a bout with the cancer, so I would ask that everybody keep Jan in your prayers. And I'm also a member of St. Paul's BCC in Florida.
All right.
I'm Judith Tobias. I'm from St. John's in Norman. I'm the pastor here.
All right.
I'm Miller Pratts. I'm on this conference stewardship, financial stewards team.
With the conference? Is that okay?
I'm Diane Wiley, and I'm the pastor of First UCC Manor and Brush Creek Salem United Church of
Right.
Tom Crummer from Berlin, Pennsylvania. I'm a member there, and I'm currently serving as the moderator of the conference.
I'm Don Ammons. I belong to the Community of Reconciliation Church in Pittsburgh, and I'm also a candidate for a doctoral degree at PTS, and I'm working with patients at Shadyside Hospital in Pittsburgh who have cancer, and I'm hoping someday, if I'm truly blessed, I will be ordained in the United Church of Christ.
Okay.
So
I'm here to learn what I don't know.
Sign up sheet on my computer, we can put your name into that and I'll send it to you. Or I can just work with the conference to make sure you get it. I'm Cindy Bailey. I'm the director of Optic, is what we call it, in Cleveland. I'm on a second floor of the building in the office of the general minister and president. And in that role, we work on philanthropy, raising money, stewardship, technology. We're in the process of redeveloping UCC.org. We're in the process of launching a service for churches called UCC Everywhere, where you can get a website, free of charge, and then for a very low fee thereafter, and it's developed with your OCWM dollars. So I want to first say thank you for all of your generosity to make these things possible. Out of the national setting where I do my work. Identity, so we have new brand guidelines, we have new logos and a color palette that I think all of you can tap into. It's at the website. And then communications. How many of you here subscribe to things like KYP or Daily Devotional? All those electronic pieces of information that go out there go through Optic to push out into the world, as well as our social media channels. So Facebook is the most active one, followed by Twitter and then Instagram. And we've been talking about something called TikTok. I don't even really know what it is. But if we want to tap into that next generation, mm-hmm. we pay attention to where they're gathering, what they're talking about, and try to meet with them where they are. All right, today I'm here to talk to you about stewardship and fund development for your churches, your conferences, and the work that you do. So what are we going to talk about? We're going to talk about why we give, why you give, right? Just sort of create a framework for the conversation. Talk about strategic insights. So there's some data. This will make Jill happy. There's data out there in the world around congregational giving and what that looks like in the aggregate across many faith traditions. Then we'll get into more practical things, like how to actually enact a active stewardship campaign. And then we'll talk about doing an audit. That's what this is about. And then what you're going to do with all this information and plot it out on a 12-month calendar to make sure that you're raising the money you need to keep your ministries thriving. So let's start with a little bit of conversation amongst small groups. You can join whatever group you want. We're going to take a couple minutes now to talk amongst ourselves about why you give, right? It's important to understand what motivates people to give, because the philanthropic work that we're doing is about the donor. It's not about us, necessarily. So we need to understand what motivates people to give, to want to be engaged. And sometimes it's not always about money, right? It's about the time you give. I heard some of you are moderators and other, you know, volunteer leadership positions, right? So you're giving your time. And maybe you're giving your treasure. I don't know. But you're also giving your talent, right? So the things that you know. Some of the things that Jill talked about really resonated with me in terms of auditing those kinds of skill sets that you're surrounded with, to really get at how to mobilize those human resources to gain financial resources to accomplish your work. So we're going to take just a couple minutes. Meet in groups. Why do you give? How does generosity touch your heart, mind, soul, and strength? With whom do you discuss your giving decisions? And what scriptural stories shape your approach to generosity and giving? So, talk amongst yourselves.
I'm here, and it's for sure a period, so I'll do it on my knees.
You
said that so quick, coming off.
Every week,
you know, you're going to go
and while we're there, we share with others.
What are you doing?
And the rest home gives us a monetary
sense of
culture. I don't know, maybe we should Well, hallelujah, because I was trying to think back how long
that's
been
my idea.
I've heard.
I think the ones that do understand
tithing and percent, how are they? Because there are many organizations much better on collecting funds.
I mean, in one sense, you could say, well, you're expected to put it in another sense.
When I think about that, there's a
I try to embrace the whole idea of
okay, if we could come back together now. I would be interested, and your colleagues in the room would be interested to hear some of the conversations. So, this table, name one thing from your conversation that resonated with you around this topic that you think the whole room should hear about.
I'll let you. You got it.
You don't know? Anybody?
It feels good to me.
It feels good. Yeah, it feels good. What do you guys think? Is it feeling good? Agreed. Back here, anything you want to add to the bigger conversation?
We're not done yet.
Oh, you're not done yet?
No, I'm really long-winded about it.
This is a hot topic.
It's really important that we talk about it. So we're not quite ready. But if you give us a few more minutes. I give them a chance to talk. Okay.
Ben, here, do you have anything you'd like to add?
I made the comment that I came to the UCC out of an evangelical conservative denomination, and so growing up in that particular environment, I just didn't want to go to hell.
That's timing, the motivation.
Timing is a way of life. And so that was sort of part of the conversation of behavioral issues. So
interesting.
And I talked about the body of Christ and the importance of providing the resources and the tools to support the body of Christ.
To put hands in feet.
Yes. Mm-hmm. If we want to really strengthen and uphold the body of Christ, we have to be prepared to do what's necessary,
right,
including financial support. Mm-hmm.
All right.
Do I?
And you think that here, were
you
ready to?
Oh, you
wanted
me to share?
You don't have to. You
really
do what you feel moved to do.
I was getting right quite close to my roots in that my parents brought me up to go to church with them on Sunday and to give me money to put in the offering plate. And when the offering plate came by, if I didn't have anything to give, I just felt not part of the body, as he was saying, the body of Christ. Like a giving responsibility starts with parents teaching that it's a responsibility to give. And then as I went matriculated from working in the service of the Lord and taking on the job as the treasurer, and I saw across the board the giving, it made me more responsible when there were some shortages, that if I hadn't paid my 10% or my part, that I would feel bad. And I remember we were trying to do some roof repairs or something, and I believe it was over $100,000 that we were short. And I just looked down at the ring that I was wearing, and I was no longer married, and I thought, well, if I toss this into the plate, they could go ahead and get that thing fixed, you know. And my pastor said to me, no, Jill, I don't think they want you to do it all by yourself. And so then I learned it was a body, a whole, we all have this responsibility. So I've never felt that I could shirk my responsibility in my part. If your 10% is only 200 and my 10% is 2,000, then that's an equitable amount we should be doing. And I just did that along the way because it makes me feel good that I'm doing my part.
Thank you for sharing.
Okay. We had an experience. I had an experience in my home church many years ago. We had a younger family, and they had, I believe, three boys at the time. They had very little to be able to give financially, to promise and pledge that it would be there. But they would do things like say, okay, 2 weeks from now we're going to have a beef dinner. And they would supply the beef because they had an opportunity to have beef coming in. And they shared their wealth in that particular thing. So I was from the time I started up at that church, I was really more aware that it isn't always the coins you put in the offering plate so much as the time and the commitment that you give.
Right, the time and the talent. There are things in the, I've been in the professional development world a long time in nonprofits, and we talk about time, talent, and treasure, or wealth, wisdom, and whatever the other W is. Anybody here know? Because it has gone right out of my brain. But I was thinking again about what Jim said earlier about those talent audits, and maybe the plate is another way. Because when I was listening to what you were saying, if somebody doesn't feel like they have money to offer, they can put that information in the plate. I can offer something else, right? Because philanthropy and generosity is relational, and with all due respect to the accountants in the world, transactions are really important, but it's not transactional. It's about relationships and working together to accomplish a shared vision and a shared mission and a shared goal. All right, well, thank you for that. Recently, there was a study done, and we pulled out these tidbits of information that we thought would be interesting to you. The first one should really resonate with a lot of people in the room. The growth or decline in attendance did not appear predictive of growth or decline in giving. So we know that people attend church 20% of the time. You have to give folks other ways to give rather than just what they have in their pockets or their checkbooks on a Sunday morning. Those churches that offer online giving see the sharpest increases in generosity because you can give anytime from anywhere and you can set up recurring gifts. So for those people who are attending 20% of the time, those recurring gifts will keep coming to you monthly or whatever the agreed upon structure is. 45% of congregations use pledging as a tool. We've heard a little bit about pledging already today. This is 70% for mainline Protestant denominations like UCC. So that's a huge percentage. And when you're talking about pledging, right, it feels good to get the pledge, but then there's the work on the back end to collect on the pledge. So we might want to mix it up and diversify how the money is flowing into the church to meet our mission and put hands and feet to the body of Christ. The other thing that correlates with increased generosity is to talk about it year-round. I think there's an incredible fear about talking about money. Whatever side of that thing you sit on, people are just not comfortable talking about the money they have, the money they can give away, the money they want to get, asking for money. And we have to find a way to lean into that and work through that and get really comfortable with that. So talking about generosity, building those kinds of relationships that are aimed at fulfilling a mission really go a long way towards opening the doors and building our comfort to talk about what at the end of the day is money. So how do we catch donations? 20% of the households, of top households in the United States, have 10% or less of their assets in liquid form, in cash. So we need to find ways to capture as much of those assets as possible through things like planned giving, which we're gonna hear more about, bequests and wills, gifts of real assets, gifts of appreciated stock, and things like that. So each one of us here is starting somewhere when it comes to this thing called generosity, and it's okay.
wherever we are, it's all okay. But we do have resources within the denomination, many of which are here today, to really help to increase our capacity and comfort with all of these avenues to increase generosity and relationships with those in our communities and in our churches who can help to build the church on the ground. So let's talk a little bit about the practical steps for building a really strong philanthropic engine in your setting. So the first thing you want to think about is engaging your leaders. And I think this is a room of people in leadership in various settings in the church, so this is the right audience to talk to. We don't have time to go through every single one of these, so I thought we would pick some of the ones that are more critical for getting started. So how many of you have heard it's important to have 100% council, leadership, board participation in contributing financially to the church? How many of you have heard this? 100% participation. This is incredibly important to launch a stewardship program to say that those closest to the church, those that exist to lead the church, have invested themselves in the mission of the organization. And this is a struggle for every kind of nonprofit entity to get 100% participation. But as you grow in your understanding of how philanthropy can work in your setting, and I'm not saying this is a cookie cutter approach and one size fits all, so as you learn and grow in all of this, you will really want to make sure you have 100% participation as you're reaching out to secure assets from tax credits or foundations or sponsors of one kind or another, or those ads we were talking about in the bulletin, all of those kinds of things. Those out there like to see that the folks running the church are invested in making sure that it's sustainable for the long run. And then number four, do you know how to answer the questions about the mission, vision, and purpose of your congregation? Someone asked, did you ask this earlier? Mm-hmm. Who here can tell me, what is the mission statement that you put out there in the world or among your congregation to tell what your congregation is about, why it exists, its purpose? Who can tell me? Anybody?
In our mission statement?
Mission statement.
I think the mission statement at my particular church is pretty strong and pretty firm. And that is to encourage a sense of love for all people, all children of God, regardless of who they are, where they are, their sexual orientation, their race, anything else. And that we are supposed to be emboldened to further the cause of the Holy Spirit in our communities and to be visible.
Okay. Go ahead.
I think our mission statement sounds like the Apostles' Creed. Mm-hmm. It's very well written, it's beautiful, it's poetic, but it doesn't apply to us. And I'm planning on working with Linda that she might come and teach us put in the mission statement who we are.
Okay.
And make it more viable for our church, where we are at this point. And then it sounds so beautiful 100 years ago. You know, I believe in God the Father Almighty, you know, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ is only. We all believe that. That was foundational. I need to now say, I believe that we have a working tool for helping the homeless. That our heart and our passion is for the less than, that the people living close to the border have a relationship with the Lord, and that we would, you know, be his feet and his arms and his legs. So I really want us to make that mission statement more who we are today. And I think we'll be more in tune with the 21st century.
I just would like to back up what you said, Judith, because if we cannot use the situations that we are in now, socially, economically, and other ways, then we're in trouble. Because what's happening around us demands an answer. Mm-hmm. And that answer comes from the mission statement and how to teach your members to embrace that statement. And I mean, that probably has to come through a learning process to understand completely what the foundation of your particular denomination is. In this case, obviously, it's the UCC Church. We have to embrace those kinds of things, and we have to make it clear that what we do is an answer to the chaos that so many of us are concerned about. That's got to be the first thing, I think, in order to get an effective mission statement that can be used
I'm going with our Book of Worship from the United Church of Christ, and I'm going with when I first started going to my home church, which I had been related to the people in that church forever, but it would have been in the 1990s, that they created a new statement of faith for the new central hymnal. And part of the affirmation of faith says, "Let us unite with the church in all times and all places in confessing our faith and in the triune God." Do you believe in God? Do you believe in Jesus? And do you believe in the Holy Spirit? It says, "By your baptism, we were made one in the body of Christ, the church. Today, we rejoice in your pilgrimage of faith, which has brought you to this time and this place. And we give thanks for every community of faith that has been your spiritual home, as we celebrate your presence in the household of faith." That makes it universal. And I think we are one, and there are several, yes, but we are one church that really stands firm in the fact that they may all be one.
Right. Now, Jill, did you
say that?
Do you want to come up and preach? It'd be probably more interesting than talking about
Korea. Did you say you do strategic planning consulting too? That might help some of you sort of get into this mission visioning, to really come up with a way to talk with external audiences, internal audiences, about what the church is, what it's about, and how to welcome people into the church. It's not just aimed at philanthropy, right? But it's a foundational thing. So part of this presentation, and I set myself a timer. And I think I have 20 minutes left, so I'm gonna start talking faster. But this slide maps to this first page of your matrix so that you can score yourself and how you're doing in these various categories. And we don't need to do this as a group. You could go back and do it with the leadership, or you could do it on your own. But I'm wondering, you can give yourself some bonus points here if you do certain things. So one is, do you develop leadership in your church by studying together? So there are some books here that are suggested reading. The Lake Institute on Faith and Giving at IUPUI has many, many classes you can take, webinars. There are lots of free tutorials on YouTube, and there's so many resources out there. I'm just wondering, does anyone here do this kind of work in group with your leadership structure in your churches or your conference? It's maybe something to think about. All right, the second thing to get you going into the fantastic world of philanthropy is storytelling. And I've been with the United Church of Christ since January of 2018, and I have met some of the most amazing storytellers in this denomination. And you know what? In my professional life, 100 years ago, I was trained as a librarian, right? So we took classes in storytelling, right? So the UCC has some amazing storytellers in it. So here are a couple questions in this category to think about. Most churches spend more on worship and music than social service. Do you describe or do you know how worship changes lives? Right, to get back to what you were saying, sometimes when you want to engage people in your mission, invite them into the church, invite them to participate in growing the church, building the church, you need to be able to say how the basic, sort of the basic unit of the church, which is worship, how does that change lives? And I think, from my experience, sometimes the thing that's most fundamental to what we do every day is the thing sometimes we don't put enough fine focus onto to be able to articulate what it really means. And I think something you read sort of starts to get at that, but I think we all need to practice, right, evangelizing, if you will, out there in the world. Were there any other questions in this category that resonate with anyone before we move on to bonus points? Number 8 is one that's kind of important. How often do people offer generosity-themed testimonials? So we started by talking about why we give, why each of us give as an individual. What if you were to turn some of those stories into testimonials and build them into the practice of your faith community to share those stories and to inspire more conversation around generosity and ultimately more generosity? I think we, as I said, we have a fear of talking about money in general. So this stuff doesn't really come naturally, but it's so important that we understand how to do these things. That's why working in these small groups with people you trust to really start moving along a trajectory of building your comfort and building your knowledge around all these things to talk about generosity on a regular basis in your churches. So, bonus points. Do you make stewardship part of every season, or do you put it off until October for stewardship Sunday because of that fear of talking about money and asking for money? So maybe we can take another little sidebar here for some generative conversation in our small groups. If you want to join a different group, feel free. What biblical stories could you use to talk about generosity in every season of the year? And in addition to preaching, where else could you talk about generosity throughout the year? I heard someone talk about Facebook. I heard someone talk about web building websites. I've heard people talk about Sunday bulletins. I mean, you have all of these, what we call them, optic channels for putting these kinds of messages out there in front of your audiences. So why don't we get in our small groups again and talk for just a couple of minutes about these two questions. What biblical stories could you use to talk about generosity in every season? And in addition to preaching, where else can you talk about generosity? Discuss.
Come on, man.
So I don't know how we go over questions like why do we give, what
that you thought about. You know, a lot of them have series of things.
My mother, sisters are very active. It wasn't, I didn't realize how much the church influenced me until I was an adult and came back. Boy Scouts, Acolyte, no church choir, because I couldn't sing, but just all the different things that I was involved with. But it was a huge congregation, probably one of the largest Black Baptist churches in Chicago. But then when I married my wife, she went to Episcopal Church. Small Episcopal church in Westchester County. And because the membership wasn't that large, I was looking at going from what I call oil machine that I grew up with, the one that was really hands on and not a lot of money. And we had always given money to churches, but I didn't realize how much more satisfaction I got.
I don't like interrupting. You guys are really getting into the conversation, which is great. So I hope we're building something here today.
I can see a tangible difference in how people benefited from it versus.
But my clock says I have 9 minutes left. So I'm sorry to cut off the conversation. But a couple of things I've heard as I've been listening to all of you. One big message is, let's not focus on scarcity. Let's focus on the things that we have. Let's tell the stories about the things that we have, the gifts that we have, and share those stories, rather than feeling that we don't have enough resources to go around, or the world is a negative place, right? You can, we can go turn on the news right now if we want to hear that. Let's talk about some positive things, because in everyone's life and everyone's setting, there are so many positive things to talk about. Over here, I heard that we need to infuse into the conversation, I don't want to put words in your mouth, that when we say we should do this, or we should do that, or what about, or what about, and we should, that there has to be in our minds the understanding and recognition and willingness to talk about the resources required to get to those shoulds and picking the right ones in the first place. Because Andy said, I'm a listener. You know, some of us are talkers, some of us are listeners. We need all of those in our leadership groups. I didn't hear much from back here. What?
We left the gentleman speak.
Well, you're in good hands with Howard. I can vouch for Howard.
Okay. Moving right along.
The third thing to think about is giving thanks. And a couple of things here I pulled out that are very simple things to do that I would encourage all of you to think about. And because we're pretty much a denomination that operates on the pledge system, these pledges that we're getting, do you send handwritten notes for every pledge that you receive? Who here does that? Excellent. Do you send a handwritten note when the pledge is fulfilled? You cannot thank people enough.
That's true.
Right? Thank you, Jake, for being here. Right? Thank you, Susan, for everything that you do to make the United Church of Great, the United Church of Christ, build a just world for all. People love to be thanked. I like to be thanked. You like to be thanked. You can't thank people enough. David, thanks for bringing us here today. And include a moment of gratitude at least monthly in worship for the generosity of the congregation. And again, this doesn't have to be about money, although we can't use those other things as an excuse not to talk about money. How many of you are doing that? A moment of gratitude at least once per month in your congregation, in your newsletter, in the bulletin, on your Facebook page, all those places where you're communicating with your audience. Okay. So let's try to put it all together. How would you say you're doing in engaging your leadership to tell stories and express thanks every month? Your matrix is going to ask you to rate yourself. We don't have to do it here today, but I really encourage you to go back and do this on your own or within your leadership groups. How will you promote planned giving? Because you saw that image of a mitten where you can catch the cash in the plate as the offering is taken every Sunday, but you can also entice people to give those non-cash gifts in the form of planned gifts and other legacy gifts for the long haul. And online giving. Who here has online giving on your website? First of all, do you have websites?
In the church. Mm-hmm. You're talking about the church. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, great. And when you put your timeline together, this is a 12-month calendar sorted by each category. So what are you going to do in the leadership category? What are you going to do in the stories category? What are you going to do in the thanks category? Anytime you create a plan like this, I think somebody said earlier you create a plan and it goes up there on the shelf and everyone's
awesome, we did that.
That only gets you this far, right? Someone has to work the plan. So you need somebody with that kind of ability to mobilize people to do what they said they were going to do to actualize the plan. All right. So once you get through all of this on your matrix, you can score yourselves and put yourselves in continuous improvement mode. I've been doing it in this business for 30 years. I am in continuous improvement mode. I'm never going to stop learning and growing and getting better at all of these things. And finally, do you have any specific questions for me about what you've heard today or anything related to the work I do at the National Setting or philanthropy within the United Church of Christ? If not, then I thank you very much.
Stretch their legs for a sec. Is everybody good?
I'm going to stretch mine, but don't worry about it.
Okay.
I'm stretching.
Stretch your legs and the rest of you. Get you a little power. So if I went last, I'd be hiking back to the city. So he's taking good care of me. While Don is doing that, let me make sure, did everybody get a copy of the material that was in the bag? These items right here? Well, great. Well, just as a reminder, Howard Hawkins, Director of Business Administration at United Church Funds, and this is Don Hill, who's the president of Don Hill Consulting, with whom we work with on planned giving. Before I go any further, I hope you've recognized how the financial ministries for the UCC really all work together. We all have distinct expertise and capabilities, but we're all working together to really strengthen the foundation of the churches, the associations, the conference, and the National Setting for the UCC. And one of the ways we're able to do that is through planned giving. Now, United Church Funds is one of the financial ministries of the United Church of Christ. We've been in existence for over 100 years, and we provide investment management services to churches and conferences and Chisholm organizations for their endowments and long-term savings. We offer a family of funds, 14 to be exact, that span the spectrum from money markets to equities to fixed income and alternatives. And we currently have over $825 million in assets under management for over 1,000 clients. The Pennywise Conference, of course, is one of our clients. Now, in managing the assets for these endowments, it's important to realize that a number of some of the largest endowments within the UCC either came about through a bequest or a planned gift that may have taken place 10, 25, 50, 7,500 years ago. And those endowments helped sustain the church today. One gift years ago helped provide the assets to help many churches continue their work and their operations within their communities. So what Don and I are going to talk about today is planned giving. And I think it's really important because people of a certain age, and I think everybody in this room is of a certain age, is probably receives something in the mail every week or so from the local museum, your alma mater, hospital, whoever, about making a plan to get to the organization. But the church oftentimes doesn't ask. And we need to do a better job of that at all levels. So in the back here, you'll see a copy of this right here. If you don't have this, you can pick one up in the back. It's a copy of the presentation that Don and I are going to go over today. And if you need an additional copy, we'd be happy to email you a copy. Here we have something called your estate planning record, which is really the first step, I think, towards making a plan gift. It allows you to go through this guide and figure out what your assets are, what your valuable properties are, and how you want things to go after you're moved on. And then we have two guides here, one for charitable gift annuities and one for the plan giving guide. And they're both very informative. I will say one thing about the plan giving guide. It's important that you look inside here and just look at all the different information, but it's also important that you look on the back. Because oftentimes with plan gifts, people focus more on what the gift is. And what this table illustrates is it's not so important what the gift is, it's more important what your objective is. What are you trying to achieve? And I guess to go back to Jill, if you know your why, you can move forward. So if you know what you're trying to achieve, then you can find the type of gift that's best appropriate for you. So with that said, Don, I'm going to turn it over to you. Don will walk through and give you a brief overview and education on plan giving. Listen very closely to this man. This man knows what he's talking about. He's very smart. And I think plan giving is really crucial to the future of the church.
Don't set me up, Howard.
I have already.
By the way, moving on is plan giving talk for dying. I also wanted to show you that I know a little bit more about plan giving than I do about technology. So hopefully this will be a little more smoothly than otherwise. Let's start with some definitions. For us, we define plan gifts as gifts that are made from assets and gifts that are part of an overall financial and estate plan. Howard mentioned the estate planning record. One of the things that we do in plan giving in the United Church of Christ is never tell you what the best gift is for you. We can provide you with the information that you need in order to make that decision, or with your financial advisor or your estate planning attorney or whoever it is. But any gift from assets in that context, we consider to be a planned gift. Now, within that category of gifts, there are deferred gifts, and those are gifts where the commitment is made now, but the full value of the gift is only realized at some point in the future. A quest is like that. You write your will, you have a charitable quest to your church. Hopefully it's a number of years before that, before you move on, and that comes to fruition. And there are two types of deferred gifts that we'll talk about. They are revocable gifts and irrevocable gifts. A revocable gift is one where it's easy to change your mind. So you can change your will as many times as you want. But some of the other gifts we're going to talk about, there are penalties to unraveling that gift. And we'll talk about that. That's going to be important when we talk about taxation and the tax advantages of doing some of these types of gifts. So that's planned gifts, deferred gifts, and then there are life income gifts. And we're gonna spend a lot of time talking about life income gifts because that's where United Church Funds can be most helpful to you in engaging people in your congregation around making this type of gift. And life income gifts are gifts where there's an irrevocable transfer of an asset, there's that word again. And in return for that, the donor or someone they designate gets some financial consideration. We won't call it income, and I'll explain why a little later. And then when they die, some amount of money goes to charity. Okay? So that's our definition piece. Request, we talked about a little bit. You might be surprised how many people in this country and in your congregation don't have an estate plan, don't have a will. So
So the first point of ministry, if you will, in doing planned giving, is encouraging that. It's actually not true that people don't have a will. People don't have a will of their own making, because the state of Pennsylvania will decide for you how those assets are disposed of if you don't make a will yourself. And let's think about this. When you do your estate plan, you're really making the biggest stewardship decisions you're going to make in your life, generally. All the stuff that you've accumulated over the course of your life, you have to decide how to dispose of it after you're gone. And so it is a question of ministry, I believe, because we're called to do that disposition in a certain way, in concert, if you will, with the gospel mandates. So that's the starting point for most of the planned giving programs that we encourage people to do. Life insurance is another charitable asset that we often don't think about. People have policies that they, life insurance policies that they created when they bought their house, when their kids were little. They can, in various ways, use that as a charitable asset. They can, in a revocable way, change the beneficiary of an existing life insurance policy. You can change that as many times as you want. You don't get a tax deduction for that. Or you can assign the ownership of that policy or of a new policy to the church. And in that case, you get a tax deduction for an existing policy that is equal to the lesser of the premium payments that you made or the cash value if it's a whole life policy. For a new policy, if you from the outset make the church the owner, then your premium payments become deductible. So it's often overlooked. Retirement assets is another one that we don't often think about. Again, in a revocable way, you can make your retirement assets benefit the church when you expire. There's also a way that up to $100,000, if you're 70 and a half or older, you can give assets to the church from your IRA, have that count towards your minimum distribution, but not have it reflected in your income. So for some people in our congregations, that's a way to make a pretty significant gift. The other thing about retirement assets, and you can help me on this perhaps, is retirement assets are a better charitable vehicle than some other things, because retirement assets are, there's a possibility of double taxation. If I leave Cindy my IRA, she has to pay taxes on the income that I would have received, and perhaps also an estate tax. So choosing between different classes of assets, retirement assets are often a better choice for charitable purposes. And then donor advised funds. I'm sure you've heard about donor advised funds. It's a way of making a gift to a charitable entity with the understanding that you can have some influence over how that money is disposed over time. There's some issues with that, but we'll do that another time. So now let's talk about life income gifts. I'm okay, thank you very much. That's sweet of you. Jill will, oh, not, that's the wrong one. Let's talk about life income gifts. A reminder that life income gifts you make an irrevocable transfer of an income, of irrevocable. Let me try again. Maybe I do need that one. Irrevocable transfer of an asset. So you have stock, or you have cash, or you have whatever it is. In return for that, you get some financial consideration. And then when you die, some amount of money goes to charity. Thank you so much. A charitable gift annuity. And I'll give you the cartoon version of what a charitable gift annuity is. It's mashing up an annuity and a charitable gift. Now, an annuity is a vehicle whereby you put money in a pool, it's invested, and you get all of that money and its income back. And then a charitable gift, obviously, is a gift that you give to a charitable entity. So a charitable gift annuity, let's say Don Hill wants to make a $50,000 charitable gift annuity gift for this congregation. And that church funds will take that $50,000 And in this hand, they'll invest the money and pay you income out of it, including that $25,000 of principal that we put into this hand at the beginning. We'll hold this $25,000 in trust for the beneficiary that you have determined you want that money to go to. The income that you receive here is based on your life expectancy, how long you're going to live. The older you are, the more money your funds can send you every month or every quarter or every year. The younger you are, the smaller the amount of money that will be sent to you because it needs to last your lifetime. Now, if you live beyond your life expectancy and this hand is gone, then we take money out of this hand. That's the way charitable gifts and annuities work. Of course, if Don makes that gift and gets hit by a bus on the street outside there, the whole amount of money goes to the charitable beneficiary. There can be one life and two life charitable gift annuities. So couples will often do it. That $50,000 gift, my spouse, if I die, continues to get the same amount of money that they would otherwise, that we got from the beginning. So it's often a good retirement planning tool for people, as well as a way to leverage a gift that wouldn't be possible otherwise because people need the income from their asset. That making sense so far? No one's fallen asleep yet, which I guess is a very good thing. Gets a little technical here. One more thing about charitable gift annuities. Since it's a pooled fund, the risk is shared among a large group of people. That's how it can work. That's how annuities work, and that's how charitable gift annuities work, because the risk is shared among a larger group of people. We have about 2,000 gift annuities now, and how much to the fund? This is a substantial amount of money. So this, I don't know if it's fun. I'll take that spot back. The thing about charitable gift annuities, if you go to worship tomorrow and there's someone in your congregation who has seen a television ad for charitable gift annuities, I don't know about here, but in Cleveland they have them, and said, I want to do that for the church, can I do that? Your answer is absolutely. And we'll tell you how to get it done later on. Because you are an institution of the United Church of Christ for whom that person wants to make this gift a beneficiary, make you the beneficiary of the gift, you're able to do it without direct cost to you. I say that because there are fees associated with doing this, but it's taken out of the fund itself rather than you're paying for it, so that the remainder is lessened by a pretty small amount of fees, less than 2%. What the fees are at this point. Make sense? So, charitable remainder trusts work in a different way, a slightly different way. I talked about charitable gift annuities being a pooled fund, so you make actuarial assumptions about what the income can be. A charitable remainder trust is a standalone entity. So Don Hill makes that $50,000 gift to this church in a charitable remainder trust, and there are two ways that the income can come to me. The first is what's called a unit trust, and every year the fair market value of the trust is determined, and I get an agreed upon percentage of that fair market value. So in year one, the trustees say 5%. These days it's 5 or 6% at most, I think, for charitable remainder trust, because they can run out of money. Charitable gift annuities don't run out of money because the state of Pennsylvania has said if we make bad choices in how we invest it or otherwise don't do it right, the United Church Funds has to find the money to pay those payments. So it's as guaranteed as you're going to get with this sort of entity. But with a charitable remainder trust, it can run out of money. So 5% is usually the top. Unit trust, you do the fair market value of the trust every year and you apply the 5%. So year one, $50,000, 5% of $50,000 you get. Year two,
Matt's response is, double your money. That's not a promise.
That's definitely not a promise. Let's say they do, it would be 5% of double back. I forgot what amount of money I said, so that's why I said double.
I think you're talking about the cartoon version.
Yes, exactly. The other way that remainder trust, our charitable remainder trust work is through an annuity trust. And in that situation, you make a gift, you agree upon the percentage, and you get that amount of money every year. So that $100,000 gift at 5%, you're going to get
$5,000
every year. Now, there might be reasons that you choose one or the other. When the economy was going full steam, everyone was doing unit trust because their payments were going up every year, and the money for the charity was increasing as well. Let's say, though, that you want to make sure there's money for the charity. So you might choose an annuity trust, because in that situation, if the market's going up, there's going to be more money for the charity. If the market's going down, though, you might choose a unit trust because your income is going to be calibrated to leave money to the charity. So, and we don't predict for you what the economy is going to do, and people who can do that seriously are non-existent. So that's the way remainder trust work. Lead trust we won't spend a lot of time on, but it's sort of the opposite of what a remainder trust does. You make a gift to the charity receives the income for some period of time, usually 20 years. And then when that period is over, the money either comes back to you or your estate or some other individual family member, whatever that you designate. It's a pretty sophisticated from a tax perspective, vehicle. And if you're interested in that, we have lawyers who can talk to your lawyers about making it happen. Then the final one we want to talk about is pooled income funds. Pooled income funds essentially function like a charitable mutual fund. You make gift to the pooled income fund for the benefit of the charity. You get income traditionally understood, that is, dividends and short-term capital gains. And the original principle is held in trust for the charity as well as any additional income that the fund receives. You get a share of the fund equal to the amount of money that you put in. Now, for some people, that's really great because the charity gets at least the original gift. With the charitable gift annuity, remember, this hand, is calculated to return 50% of the original gift. Now, we outperform that a lot of the time. Charity gets more than 50%, but that's the way that the calculations are done. So that $50,000 gift I made to this congregation, if I die on time, and if the economy does what it's supposed to do, according to the calculations, the church would get $25,000. Does that work?
Very well.
Okay. You want to talk about this house?
We can move on and come back to it.
Okay. So, for those of you who are interested in putting together a plan giving program, now that we talked about what we're talking about, I'm going to run through a couple of these things. And I'm going to point to you to help me with some of this. Crafting and make the case is Jill's why. It used to be years ago when people had a particular type of relationship with institutions, it was enough to just do the educational piece and tell people, how they could make a gift to the church. Now, increasingly, we have to tell people why it matters, not just now, but into the future. And so that's sort of a different kind of case than your normal case. Let me tell you what I think case is. And there are people in the room who've heard this a million times, so they're just going to just close your ears. Is articulating what our values are. People remember still speaking. The values there were radical inclusivity, help me, changing lives, continuing testament, yeah. But our particular expression of them as a congregation is what we need to articulate. So there's vision. I mean, there's values. There's vision. What does success look like? There are no hungry children within 5 miles of this church. Whatever it might be. So values, vision, strategy. How do we make that happen? In addition to the food cupboard, it might be supporting school lunch programs. It might be a variety of things. So values, vision, strategy. I call it witness. You call it storytelling, but I'm an old Baptist. So telling the stories of why it matters and how it matters and how we've had success. And then asking people. If you don't ask, chances are it's not going to happen. So all of those things is what I mean when I say craft and make the case. And there are various other ways that that can happen. Jill has a different way of talking about it. But I think essentially we're talking about the same components. Mm-hmm. Now in the plan giving way of doing this case business, values and vision become really important because those are the less mutable parts of what we're talking about. Strategy, witness, and the ask become illustrative in a sense because we can't predict what ministry in this place is going to look like 25, 30 years from now, which is the time horizon for many of the people that we're talking to about this. And especially, I think, now, you know, the church that we grew up in, for the most part, doesn't exist anymore. And so asking people to consider making a gift to support long-term ministry has to be based on values and vision rather than what we're doing in this moment, to my mind, to successfully happen.
That's great.
Yeah. So crafting and making the case. Choosing and equipping leaders. Nothing will tear a congregation apart more quickly than the question of if the pastor should know what people give, if the pastor should ask people for money, all those sorts of things. And I'm not here to sell you on a particular way of doing it, but I think you have to come to some conclusion about that. I will tell you that my own view is that if we can't trust our pastors with that information, we have a problem. We have a problem around talking about money,
right,
and about other things. People say, well, they'll treat me differently if they know what I give. Really? They might. So anyway, determining the role of the pastor is really important. We talked about expecting financial commitment among our leaders. One of the things I want to say about plan giving leadership, though, is that it doesn't have to be an estate plan attorney. It doesn't have to be a CPA, even though those people are useful on a plan giving committee. It needs to be someone who can articulate the case and is willing to do that and willing to make the commitment themselves. Those are the most important people. You can buy the expertise of those other places in other places. But having someone who's a member of the congregation who can talk passionately about the mission and ministry of that church is probably the most important thing you can have on a plan giving committee. So, and then the second thing here is building infrastructure. We talked a lot about policies, and I'm a Holy Spirit guy, but I do believe that having policies in place is really important. And in this context, there are really three types of policies that we want to talk about. Gift acceptance policy, which we talked about a little earlier. Investment policy, which United Church Funds can help you with. How is the money invested? And then spending policy. And the spending policy is probably the one that gets the most attention. Because it requires that the church make a determination about what its priorities are. And how you're going to make the case to people about what the money is going to do. There's some congregations who say that we as current members of this congregation need to cover its current expenses so that the money from an endowment needs to go to the expansion of ministry and doing things that other than worship and paying the pastor, that's our responsibility. There are other people who say we're going to create an endowment to take the building off the table so that all the money that you give goes to ministry, traditionally understood. other people will say, we're going to let people not eat in this community because we have these rules about endowment not going to this or that. We're going to use it for whatever we need to use it for to meet ministry needs in this place at this time. Those are all, to my mind, perfectly faithful decisions to make based on where you are. But making those decisions is really important, and making them ideally before you get that first big gift. When I worked in the denomination, the panic call I would always get was, we just got a big gift, and everyone thinks that we should spend it on X. What do I do? I think you want to avoid that. It's a very different conversation to have when you have money staring you in the face. Recognition, I want to talk about for a second, too. The second thing that will tear a congregation apart, other than the role of the pastor, is naming something after someone, especially if they're still alive, which is a dangerous thing. We've all seen how that works. People sin, to use another my old Baptist things, and so what do you do about that? And I'm agnostic about recognition policies too, but having the conversation about them I think is really important. People tell you they don't want to be recognized for their gift. I don't think they're telling you the whole truth. What they're saying is, I want to be recognized in a way that is consistent with the values of this community and my values. And so we have to think differently about how to make that happen.
Do you want to add anything to that? I'm just picking up a shoe for that. Do you want to talk about recognition at all? No? Okay. Making the case, I sort of put myself out there before. So, just a couple of things, five things about building your plan getting program. Staying in feasibility mode, I think, is really important. And feasibility, I'm going to pick on Jill this time. Talk about feasibility, what feasibility does. Can you do that?
It tells you what your capacity truly is and tells you what's possible, in a nutshell.
And it's also a way of testing the case.
It does a reality check.
So we always have to be in conversation with people in our congregation about what their capacity is, how they feel about the case, how they feel about the leadership of the congregation. Those are all questions that you'll get in the feasibility study. And so we always have to do that. Just because people show up on Sunday morning doesn't mean that we understand the answers to those questions from people. And they're key, I think, to making a successful ask. Understanding how donors give, we talked about that a little bit. I don't know about Bitcoin and all that other stuff, but there are lots of ways that people can use their assets to deploy for the church. So part of learning about ways people give is talking about planned giving and the other things that, the ways that we talked about today. But understanding not just how people give, but why people give. Making the decision about recognition, cultivate and educate. Planned giving is really a long-term game. And I know that there are congregations that think they have limited bandwidth, and so they're going to concentrate on doing that yearly stewardship campaign. And I think that's appropriate. But I also think it's appropriate to try to find a group of people to begin the conversation about planned giving. If you look at, as we talked about earlier, successful congregations in terms of financial sustainability, they have a variety of income streams, and planned endowments is a big part of that. So finding a way to do that is really important. And then providing resources to donors and prospects. And Howard's going to talk right now about one of the ways that you can do that. And then we'll find some time for questions after. Unless people have questions now on what I've done so far. I feel like I've been talking nonstop for like an hour and a half. Maybe it's not that long. But. Howard?
Yeah. I had the pleasure of speaking with someone yesterday that requested some planned giving material, the brochures I showed you earlier. And just to step back for a moment, all the brochures I showed you are on our website. www.ucfunds.org. You don't need to remember that. It's in the material I handed out to you. It's on the back of the brochures. And there was a slide that we went by quickly, but just to allude to that, Millie Hernandez, her picture and contact information is on the back of two of the brochures that you have. She is the individual with whom someone from your church or you might speak to about making a planned gift. Millie is excellent at walking you through the process, learning what your objectives are, and helping execute and make that gift a reality.
We can go back to that slide if we can.
Okay. And just while Donna's doing this, I just want to put in my two cents on two things you've heard today: investment policy and spending policy. Don't be intimidated by those phrases. I like to look at them as roadmaps. These are the maps that will tell you today and for future committee members going forward, when that committee turns over, what the rules and guideposts are and how to act in various different situations. The economy will change, committees will change, but the roadmap is always right there to guide you in terms of moving forward.
See, I told you I knew more about planning than I did about this. So. Yeah, I'm just trying to get rid of this thing here, but let's not do that. Let's not waste time on that.
Church Funds, investing with a mission.
So, in addition to the printed material we've created, which is available to all UCC churches, pastors, congregants, and so forth, what we wanted to do was provide not only printed material, but we wanted to give people access to planned giving information 24/7. Everybody has a telephone or a mobile, everybody has a laptop, a tablet or whatever, or their laptop at work. We wanted to make it convenient for people to think about and to learn more about planned giving when it was convenient for them. So we were trying to figure out how could we provide this information, but how could we also provide it in a way that churches could customize what we call a microsite to reflect the values, culture, even the look and feel of their church and of their website. So what we did was we created a microsite that we could tweak and have it made flexible, that a church could really customize it to reflect who they are and their website. So if we click on the second one, little friend, if you scroll down. Now, what we did was we came up with four different themes, corporate, colorful, and so forth. And the second theme is the theme that's based on the colors of one of our clients in Biloxi, Mississippi. So, here's what we did. We came up with a microsite, and it allows the church, or in this case, maybe even the conference, to create a site that reflects who they are and what they do. So what you'll see at the top here is you'll see, you can't see it, but I'll give it to you. The tabs are what is planned giving, why give, testimonials, let's talk, and contact. What you'll see is a rotisserie of pictures here. These pictures can be used from a library of pictures that we offer, or if you would like, you can provide us with pictures based upon the specifications that we provide, and those pictures will be shown on the microsite here for you. Up in the upper left-hand corner, it says, God is still speaking, United Church of Christ. That's a placeholder, because that's where your church logo would go. Now, we've got the tabs up here, but you'll notice as we continue here, this is all linear. There are no pages. Everything is up and down on this site to make it really easy to navigate. I should also mention that what you see here would show up the same whether you're on your laptop, mobile, or what have you. What we have here is a brief description of what is Plan Giving. It's a three-paragraph text. It really lays out in a concise manner what is Plan Giving, the importance of it, and the difference it can make in your church. Now, we have standard text here, but again, if there was text that you wanted to provide for us, we could use that text instead of the standard text here. Then we have the Why Give section. Again, a brief explanation of why it's important to give. And then we have two other items here. One is the reasons to build your UCC church legacy. We can provide you with text for that. Or, better yet, you can give us the reasons why it's so important for the church legacy. Again, what Don mentioned about Plan Giving, looking out into the future, not so much today. Making sure that the children who are growing up in the church and in the larger community reap the same benefits that you have as being a member of that church or the larger UCC. Here we have a video. And we normally recommend that this video be no longer than two and a half minutes. And this is Reverend Hal from Plymouth Congregational in Fort Collins, Colorado. And they created a video, and of course they take their sermons, so they have the technology and wherewithal to have made that video. However, you can make that same quality video with your own telephone. And you can buy a $6 stand on Amazon. We provide you with all the tips on lighting, text, and everything else. And you can make your own video, and it will look just as good. I think the video is really important because it gives the pastor or maybe a member or members of that stewardship committee the opportunity to really speak to the importance of Plan Giving for the church and to really outreach and touch with potential donors or pastors. It's also a way to go beyond the congregants in your church and speak to the larger community. Because in the other sessions that we've had today, usually every UCC church is really active and a participant of that larger community. And the larger community benefits from the presence of that UCC church and its community. So those people may be just as interested in making a gift as congregants. Then we scroll down to what matters most. And what you'll see here, and this is just for a sample purpose, are six icons: building fund, pastor's fund, youth ministry, music, outreach, and endowment. You can list up to six icons and six purposes on the microsite, or you could just have one. But this really explains to a person, if you make a plan and give to this church, here's what it can go towards, and here's why it's important. And when you click on one of these icons here on the text, a brief description tells the potential donor how those monies, how that gift will be used to maintain that building, or the pastor's fund, or youth ministry, or music, or outreach, or endowment. We had one client that had five, and again, you're not beholden to use these five. It can be any purpose that you select. And we have a library of icons that you can select and associate with the purpose, but they have five specific purposes, and the sixth was basically open, i.e. unrestricted, so that if someone made a gift to that fund, it was up to the church's discretion as to how those funds would be used. Any questions thus far? When we scroll down a little bit, this goes back to what Don and Jill and Cindy and Rob Kathy talked about, is how to give. So it can be a gift from your will, It can be charitable gift annuities, retirement accounts, gifts of appreciated assets, stocks, bonds, mutual funds, personal property such as real estate, no gas stations, and gifts of life insurance. But again, when you click on one of these, working with you will provide a standard sheet and text in terms of helping somebody better understand how to move forward with making that type of gift. At the end of this, Michael said, we also talk about we're not giving financial advice here. So we strongly urge, recommend, and suggest that individuals speak with their attorney or their financial planner or their wealth manager or whomever before moving forward with a gift. Now here, the testimonials are blank, but on the Michael site, you can do one of two things. Some of our clients have chosen to show a picture of an individual or a couple with their names beneath it and a brief description of how and why they made the gift and how they benefited from it. The beauty of that is that these are people in church. Anyone who sees that probably knows that individual, and they can go up to them and really start a discussion. They, in fact, become your ambassadors to help create an environment for wanting to make a gift. Other clients have used a video and of an individual donor or donors talking about why they made a gift. Also, very powerful, very impactful. We scroll down a little bit more, and now we talk about Let's Talk. And if you scroll down a little bit more, we'll talk about there'll be three questions. I would like to learn more about supporting the UCC Church or the national setting. I've already included the UCC Church or the national setting in my estate plans, or I haven't done so, but I'm looking to do so and I'd like to learn more. What you can see in this white space here, and it's not showing up, is that when we say let's talk, this is when this individual, after having visited this site, after having thought about it, maybe have talked with a few people, they will submit their contact information, their name, their email address, and with a brief message box in terms of what they're looking to talk about or learn more about. And that's great because now you've engaged somebody. They're letting you know that they're ready to talk and think about making a gift. And we scroll down a little bit more. And then we talk about contact us. And you can list from 1 to 3 people here in terms of contact. So it may be the pastor, with 1 or 2 members of the stewardship committee or what have you. And these are the individuals that would be designated contacts for a donor or potential donors. One of these people will be the lead contact to receive that email when somebody says that they want to talk. So again, what we're trying to do is really provide churches and congregants with access to planned giving, to take some of the mystery and remove that from the planned giving process, make it easy, make it simple, not make it daunting, and to really engage and to ask people to think about leaving a gift to the church as well. So we have the printed material, we have technology, we'll be working with Optic in the future in terms of really providing churches with more information that they can dispense to their congregations as well. Right now, we're offering the Michael sites free of charge for 2 years, so if you think your church might be interested, I saw some tents pick up when I said that. But we'd be happy to work with you on this. Again, we think planned giving is of the utmost importance to the church, to the conferences, into the larger national setting, in terms of allowing the UCC to do what it does best. So that's pretty much it. I know we're a little over time. Any questions? Again, our contact information is in the brochures. You can go to our website and see this information. You can download it. We've got Millie, myself, Don Del there. We're available. Yes, yes, they have.
Okay, so to add this micro, we can add this microsite onto our existing websites that we have for our churches?
Yes.
And so basically, I mean, at UCFmicrosites.com, we would be able to go through and work with you and tailor this? I mean, are there sort of instructions as to how we do that?
I'll give you a quick example. Basically, if you have a website, either that you've done on your own or maybe you're working with Cindy with Optic, maybe I don't want to go down that road too much.
No, well, we do have that website development, so that's fine.
Okay. So, but basically, if you have a website, you would essentially have a discussion with us, and once the committee decided to move forward, we would send the church an application. And that application serves as the roadmap. So that application, once you complete and send it to us, we'll review it and then work with our vendor in terms of setting up the microsite. But that application gives us, it delineates every step of what that microsite will look like. And then once the microsite is created, we come back to you to see, okay, is this what you had in mind? Is this what you wanted? And then that microsite is connected to your website. It's seamless. So Don, can you go back to the microsite real quick?
How does that part work? How do you get it connected to an existing website?
Yeah, so once whoever has developed the website for the church, they're able to make that connection. We provide them with the technical aspects of it, and they make the connection.
Okay.
All right. In the upper right-hand corner, I feel like the Wizard of Oz. But in the upper right-hand corner, it says back to main site.
Yeah.
Okay, that main site will be
right. The
church's website. Yeah. So it's seamless. It's back and forth.
I just think this would be such a wonderful thing if the conference can do this and we can put it up there and say, this is how we've done this for Penn West. UCF will tailor this to your local church. You know, here's how you do it. I think that would be a wonderful, I mean, if we could work with you on that, I think that would be fantastic.
Absolutely. So I don't want to take it. Are there any other questions? Don, is this something you wanted to?
No.
So now it's time for the other Don.
I didn't know if there was a break.
Do you want to take a 5-minute break or?
Yeah, let's do that. 5-minute break.
Sunday.
changing their
insurance coverage as well. So you want to make sure that any exposures you have, you're going to be covered under your insurance policy. Some property insurance is the first thing I want to hit on, and it's probably the most important thing you really need to understand is insuring your building to a replacement cost value. As most of the churches in the Pentecost Conference are older churches, that only becomes more important because at the time of a loss, you want to make sure that your insurance policy is going to rebuild with a like kind and quality building. I've heard some churches say that, you know, if there was a loss here, we wouldn't rebuild to what we had, something that fits the congregation in today's time. And that may be true, but the problem is if it isn't a total loss and you have a large partial loss and you don't have enough value on your insurance policy, there's going to be a lot of out-of-pocket expense, or perhaps you may not even be able to afford to participate in what the insurance premium or the policy will pay and what, you know, your out-of-pocket expense will be. So then you really are in a pickle with trying to figure out what's your next step. So the important thing is you should look at your insurance policy or call your agent, have a review, make sure you're on replacement cost. That value is sometimes hard to figure out, and churches struggle at times to even know what your replacement cost value is. Our agency, we suggest you get a professional appraisal, but we do have the ability to give you a value that's very close to probably what a replacement cost would be. The difference between me and a professional appraisal is they will charge you several thousand dollars. I do it free of charge when I provide you the proposal. So if really the professional appraisal is, let's call it not in the cards for you to pay somebody like that, I suggest at least trying to review that with your agent to see, you know, where did this value came from? Because sometimes you may have that value that doesn't increase over 10, 15, 20 years. You know, there's inflation, and each year the cost of labor, the cost of materials will increase. So your building value on your in your insurance policy should be increasing as well. I hear other times that, you know, my value, I've heard, is only worth X amount of dollars. And sometimes a value that you hear may be a little confusing because it may be referred to as the real estate market. And the real estate market is something where you can what the going rate is to sell your building in today's world. And that's not what it would take to rebuild it. So don't be confused with real estate value versus replacement cost value. Something the insurance board does that very few programs out there do is provide you a wealth of additional coverage at the time of loss. They have added values in there that will help you rebuild. And one of those advantages is they have what's an investment that adds an additional 25% of extra value to your policy in case your value by me was valued a little low. So it provides you the comfort knowing that at the time of the loss, you're going to get not only what the building limit shows on the policy, but an additional 25%. Other policies that you may have actually do the opposite. Is if you don't have enough value on your policy at the time of the loss, they can penalize you. There's language in there that says you need to carry so much insurance
in order for that limit that you're showing on the policy to apply. So not only are you underinsured, but then you could be penalized further, which means more out-of-pocket expense. So it's important to communicate with your agent, you know, at least have him or her come out and review coverage, talk about the replacement cost side. Liability side, you know, obtaining the correct liability coverage, that's a hard question because there's so much unknown. It's not like your building's sitting here and you can give a certain amount. The liability comes from a claim and what they want to sue you for. And, you know, there's that unknown. So you may ask the question to me or your other agent, how much limit should we carry? And our agency suggests that you carry at least what your building value is. At least a minimum of $1 million occurrence. So if you have a $3 million building, you should be looking at your general liability occurrence limit being at $3 million. That's usually where an umbrella policy comes in. If you don't have an umbrella policy and you're a larger church, you really should consider it. Now the insurance board, they provide an umbrella up to $30 million, which is really a lot of money. I've heard that you don't need that much money. We don't need that much coverage. But I try to give a few examples that may relate to them in today's world. One example is if they have a child that's injured at the church, and that child suffers a serious injury and may require constant care for the rest of their life, how much coverage would you need? Would $1 million be enough? Would $5 million be enough? You know, would $30 million be enough? It's hard to say, you know, but that's something that you could really think about and say, well, that really could happen. Also, it could be a group of church members that jump into the car and go to a meeting. While they're in the car, they're involved in an accident. Maybe a few of them become seriously injured. Is that $1 million policy going to be enough to pay for, you know, maybe some pain and suffering or some, you know, loss of life or something like that? It's hard to say. So, you know, these are things that can happen, and you want to make sure that your congregation's going to be covered. And those situations, by having these multi-million dollars of coverage, can obviously help in those situations. The general liability policy, you know, that I've been talking about is going to cover you for the majority of your exposures, but you know, with that general liability policy comes additional coverages that you have to purchase. And with the insurance board, they provide a lot of coverage in their policy. And you know, a few things that you need to really make sure that your policy does have is coverages like pastoral counseling. And you need to be aware of who's covered. Is it just your licensed minister? Is it your youth group leader? Is it your Sunday school teacher? You know, these are all things that you know, you need to make sure that you're aware of, not only if you have the coverage, but who's going to be covered at the time of loss. Directors and officers, people that sit on the boards and make decisions, you know, your personal assets are at risk. You want to make sure that, you know, the church has a policy that will protect your assets for those of you that serve on the board. Employment practices liability. This is a coverage that not only will cover employee claims, it will also cover the volunteer positions of the churches. Covers harassment, wrongful termination, unequal opportunity to hire because of their race or physical abilities, things like that. These are claims where we're seeing churches are, you know, calling up and saying, You know, we just let the 85-year-old janitor go. Now he wants to sue us because he says, you know, that I can't do the job, you know, that he couldn't do the job, so, you know, he wants to turn back and sue the church because of they let him go because of his age. You know, these are things that, you know, you just need to be aware of, and, you know, with your policy, you know, employment practices should be on the liability side. Something else that's popping up is the cyber liability. You know, the hacking of personal information that the church may have on their computer system. It also covers, you know, the information you have in a filing cabinet as well. So if you're thinking that your church is just online and susceptible to some type of cyber threat, again, this coverage can also provide you the social security numbers that you have on file in the filing cabinet. It could be from 3 pastors ago that you've never, you know, threw away, or you've left the filing cabinet open and somebody's now going through it and sees this information. So cyber liability is another important one that you really need to consider. And then, you know, I talked about the church accident. You know, the church should be covering hired and non-owned auto. These are the autos that you would use on behalf of the church, your own personal auto. So those are protections that the church needs to make sure that they carry as well. And of course, the sexual misconduct. You know, we all know how important that is to have at least some coverage there. You know, again, not every policy is the same. So, you know, you may have sexual misconduct coverage on the church policy now. You just want to make sure that it's going to cover all 3 phases of that claim. And there's a medical on there. There's also defense coverage, and then there's settlement. Some sexual misconduct policies may only cover medical. They may only cover defense. And then if you're found negligent and have to pay X amount of dollars, well, the insurance policy then says, well, we're not set up to pay settlement. That's up to you. So just need to be aware that just because you see sexual misconduct on there or sexual abuse on there, that it's going to provide you the protection you need. Something else on the policy is who is an insured. All insurance policies will have a definition on there that says who is an insured. What makes the church kind of special is the church has, you know, obviously a bunch of members, a bunch of volunteers, a bunch of employees that make up the church. A good insurance policy will cover all those. The insurance board's policy basically has language in there that says we will cover volunteers, which basically includes anybody. So if you're part of the church and you're doing something and it's part of the claim and the church is named in the lawsuit, you know, our insurance board policy will protect you. So you can feel rest assured if you do have the policy, whether you're just a volunteer or a member or, you know, an employee, we're going to pick up the coverage for you. Something else you may want to start to consider if you haven't already is write policy and procedure manuals for the church. Now, there's a bunch of different ones that you could, that really the church needs to make sure that they have in place. You can form a safety committee, and what that safety committee should be able to do is then, you know, start to write some of these policies. Some policies you may need are employee and or volunteer work duties, evaluations, returning after an injury, or even safety for your, you know, employees. In the children aspect of your ministry, the children and youth, the abuse prevention. I'm sure, you know, in the state of Pennsylvania, everybody realizes that you need to have some type of policy procedure in place, but yet I still visit churches that do not have this in place, and it's mandatory. So it's something that you really need to address at your church, saying, hey, we need to have something in there. You know, the background checks that are involved in this, for the adults that are around them. The activities that, you know, your children need to do, you need to have some type of policy set up for that. Consent forms, daycare and nursery safety, playgrounds, if you have it. Some of the church in general is your member safety. You know, your slips and falls, your church grounds, building maintenance. These are all things that you really need to have something written down so that you can follow from year to year. Of course, your finances as well. You know, talked about counting money, and you know, the audit reporting. These are things that you really need to make sure are in place and you follow. You've probably all heard about the church, the Presbyterian Church in the South Hills, West Westminster. You know, it can happen. I'm sure, you know, a lot of churches around here would maybe miss a little bit less rather than the amount that they've seen. But I've had some calls now that, I guess from what I understand is there wasn't even any coverage that Westminster had for employee dishonesty. So they're really struggling right now. So the insurance board provides $1 million of coverage for employee dishonesty. So again, employee dishonesty would be also a volunteer position. Don't have to be bonded. Don't have to have a special name appear or something like that. So the insurance board does have this coverage in place. It's the importance of having an insurance policy, having a good insurance policy. Now, after an incident has been reported, the procedure policies will not only help protect the church, but it will also help protect that person as well of the incident. Because if somebody comes up to you and approaches you and says, you know, so-and-so did something, maybe you're not sure what to do. Now, if there's a policy and procedure manual in place, you can follow that. You know, you can follow it step by step so that nothing's inadvertently missed. Having the ability to follow those steps will not only expedite the incident, which can help reduce the possibility of it turning into something larger than possibly it needs to be. Because the first thing I think people want is to be known that something's happened, so that they are, so it is addressed, and that you're working on trying to resolve the problem. We've, you know, dealt with some claims in the past where, you know, they want to know what's going on, and they don't want to wait a day, they don't want to wait a week. You know, they want to, you know, they want to be called, they want to be know that everything's being handled. So, you know, those are the types of claims that, you know, can escalate into something huge where they may contact an attorney or something like that. And then, you know, then you really have a mess on your hands. So, again, I urge you, anytime you hear something, to give your agent a call. Let them know what's going on. Because the fact is, you know, your responsibility with the insurance policy is to notify your company of a possible claim. And, you know, so I get calls all the time, you know, well, I'm not sure what's going to happen, but, and I say, well, it's a good thing that you called me because we want to make sure and we follow up on this because they're saying, well, they're going to be fine. They said that, you know, there's nothing wrong, but we just want to make sure that you're aware. Well, I appreciate that. That way I can make sure that if something does happen, if there is medical bills that happen or something like that, that then we have a claim started and then we can just reach out to that family and say, look, you know, we're going to make sure that, you know, her medical bills are going to be paid and that everything will be okay. Obtaining certificates. This is the part where you want to open your doors to your community, which will help you, and will help your community as well. The thing about it is there's certain risks, and the risk is much greater on your behalf because you're allowing them to come into your building and use your facility. The problem with this is these outside groups need to provide you a certificate of insurance. I get asked, well, who should we ask? Which group should we ask? And really my response is everyone. It could be a small group, it could be a large group, but if they're there on a constant basis, you really need to ask for a certificate. You just can't predict where your next claim is going to happen. So we always say, get a certificate off everybody. Show that they have general liability insurance.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Is there certain limits that you should require them to have on their general liability?
Some companies, they want this equal general liability, general liability limits of what the church has. So if you have $1 million or $3 million, it should be. I know in today's world that doesn't always happen because obviously the higher limits, the more cost. You may have a small group, they may be able to only afford a $300,000 general liability versus $1 million. Better to have $300,000 than none, because the part is, you know, you want to make sure that you offset some of that risk to these groups. And by at least them having a certificate, having some type of liability insurance in place, with you being named the certificate holder, and also the named additional insured on their policy, provides you the protection. Because if a claim did occur from one of these groups, their insurance is going to become primary. They're going to represent the church, they're going to pay settlement, and then if it happens to spill over and it becomes higher than what the group has, then your policy would become secondary. The other, you know, exposure you have of these outside groups is not only the liability side of one of these groups, somebody injuring themselves here, but they can also do damage to the building accidentally. You know, they could leave a coffee pot plugged in for overnight, cause a fire. Of course, then you get the call and say that the church just suffered fire and it was because the AA meeting left the coffee pot plugged in. Certainly, you're going to want to call your insurance company and start a claim, but really it wasn't your fault. And the nice thing about a general liability policy is that group's policy will provide some coverage for that. So it will help protect on those, let's call it those small physical damage building losses. So that's another way having a certificate in place will protect you. With this certificate, depending on how big the group is, it could be a nursery school that's using space there that is a separate entity from the church. So you know you're going to have some workers in there for the nursery school. Well, that certificate needs to reflect also that there's workers' compensation that's carried with this nursery school, or it could be, you know, some other organization that may be needing in your church. So that's something important. Make sure it's current. You know, each year you continually need to ask for a certificate. I've heard before that some churches say, well, that's why we have insurance. When something happens here, we're going to cover it. Well, you're probably right. you know, your insurance policy will pay a claim 99% of the time for what happens at your location by an outside group. But the problem is, your insurance policy is only rated on your ministry. It's not rated on all the outside entities that's using space, whether it's, you know, a basketball pickup game on Tuesday nights or AA on Thursday nights. You know, all this extra activity creates more exposure for the church in a claim. So then the insurance company says, well, okay, we'll pay the claim, but now we're going to start to charge you for this added exposure. They also have the right to remove any claims-free crediting you've been receiving. You know, everybody says when you have a claim, it goes up. Well, yeah, it could be true. They're not maybe surcharging you. They could be saying, they look at it as, well, you've been claims-free for 5 years, so we've added crediting to your policy. Now you have a claim, now you're back at square one. So that's kind of where you see your insurance premium rising from something like that. And if the risk is too much, you know, they could just possibly cancel you. I've seen that happen as well. So, again, the importance of obtaining these certificates and the church's name appearing in the certificate holder box and being named as an additional insured is really important. So just make sure that you're aware of that. User agreements. You know, this is nice to have as well. It's a great tool if used properly. You know, the insurance board, their website has some samples of user agreements. My agency also has some samples as well that you might be able to use for a user agreement. Even getting on the internet and Googling may result in something that could use. But probably the best advice is have an attorney draw your user agreement that specifically applies to that application. That's probably the best way to cover you. But you know, having some type of user agreement in place is recommended. So just be aware of that as well. Hold harmless agreements. This is a great resource as well. You know, if you have a very active ministry, it can reduce potential negligence on the church's part by having these participants sign waivers every time, you know, just not once, but having them sign each and every event that you know, you're having. And you know, it just kind of reaffirms of what you're doing and what, you know, they are wanting to participate in, which just kind of brings it to their attention each time. And if you're obtaining these children permission slips, I just want to urge you to make sure maybe both parents sign. You know, some kids have split families nowadays. You know, that, you know, they may live with the mother, but then the father doesn't know what's going on. We've had claims before where the mother signed the permission slip. The child's got injured, father had no idea what was going on, so he wants to get the attorney to sue because, you know, his child went to a high ropes course and fell and broke his arm. And we've seen that happen as well. So hold harmless agreements are good. Contractors. You're going to need work done at your church. And the thing about this is you need to make sure that who you hire, they have the insurance to provide you the protection you need for them coming onto your premises. You know, the insurance that they have should be current, and you shouldn't allow them to start anything until they provide that certificate of insurance. You know, by them providing this, it provides you protection not only while they're on there, on your premises working, it provides you protection later down the road in case they do some type of faulty workmanship. You can go back and file a claim against their carrier because, you know, they didn't install the roof properly and now the roof's leaking and now you need another contractor up there to replace the roof. not only should the general liability section be completed, the workers' compensation section of it should be completed as well. You know, they're going to have workers there. If one of those workers injures themselves, you know, you want to make sure that you're protected because you want his policy to pay. If he didn't have the workers' comp, it's possible that it would, the claim would go against the church. And obviously, you want something like that.
How would that pertain to people volunteering to come over? We have a gentleman that always volunteers and comes over and mows and trims. And what if something happened? Would he be covered with us?
Yes. You know, your insurance, at least the insurance board's policy, it's a volunteer position. That's the way they look at it. So if he injures himself, you have a medical limit that would pay for his injuries.
Okay.
Now, if he caused damage to something else, say he was mowing and a rock kicked out, and it hit a car that was driving by, again, your insurance policy would react to that and fix the car.
Okay.
That's the difference between if you hire somebody to cut your grass and they have a certificate of insurance to show the general liability and the workers' comp. Again, if that contractor's on there doing that same thing, then that's where his policy would pay for that. But volunteering, that's a church mission. And your policy would cover something like that.
Thank you.
No problem. That's really all I have. So I don't know if there's any questions, but I certainly would answer them now. If you think about something, you can certainly email me or call, whatever you prefer. But I'm available to answer questions. I certainly encourage you to call your agent, get in touch with that person. Do a review of your insurance policy. You know, that's part of your ministry, is to make sure that you're going to be properly covered for the activities that you do or that maybe you're going to try. You know? What happens if you allow somebody to come onto your property to use space? Are we going to be covered for something like that? Better to find out before than afterwards.
Don, this isn't so much a question, but for people who are looking for resources, especially for like the Safe Conduct Workbench on the Insurance Board website, you know, as far as child, you know, the child protection piece, but, you know, that's on the insuranceboard.org is the website you'll want to go to. And also, for those of you who have curiosity about the state laws, the Pennsylvania state laws on child abuse certifications and that sort of thing, that is available on our site, penwest.org. If you click resources, you'll see a section under child protection laws. Heather Kimmel, who is the attorney for the United Church of Christ, Office of General Counsel, provided us with some excellent work on that some time ago. So.
Good point. Yeah, I had that in my notes. I must have went over that, but yes. So the insurance board's website is very useful, and as Dave mentioned as well, you know, the Penn West Conference website has materials on it to help start, you know, protecting your ministry. So, any other questions? All right. Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
So before we close, I want to ask if are there any concluding remarks from any of our presenters, anything that as you've gone through the course of the day you wanted to say, oh, I just wanted to get this last minute thing in, or are you good? You're good? Any questions from anyone else? Last minute questions, something that popped into your mind that you thought, before I go, I should ask this this elite group before we depart today. All right, yes, please remember to hand in to me. I'll be kind of hanging out around the door area, the evaluation forms. All right, I want to thank everyone. Let's give our presenters. Thank you. Thanks to all of you for being here with us today. I hope that this information was valuable and useful to you in your church's ministries. And before we head out, will you join me in prayer? God, we thank you for inspiring and uplifting us today with our guests from the United Church of Christ Financial Ministries. Bless them and bless their ministries, and bless the ministries of each and every one of our churches. As we go forth today, may we do so to love and serve you faithfully in this world. And we thank you, O God, for every blessing that you give to us. Lead us now, in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you all. Go in peace. Good to see you. I'll be over by the door.
Okay.
Avis, thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Steve, thank you.
Oh, you
thank
bet.
Thank you so much again. Really appreciate it.
You bet.
Thank you. All right. Thanks, Avis.
See you soon.